What's going on, everyone? Happy birthday to me, and I'm doing this special video for you guys today because it's my birthday. I like doing a special video every year on my birthday, and this year, back a couple months ago, Sean Chandler did a really cool video where he actually went through and talked about each of his favorite movies from the years that he's been alive. I got 22 years now on me, I got 22 films to talk about, and I love this idea, so I gotta give him a big shout out, friend of the channel. I have to do this. I thought it would be fun. Like, it's a cool birthday video. So without further ado, we're going to go through 22 years of my life, starting in 1997 and going forward through there. You guys are ready. I'm ready. Strap in. Get some popcorn. Get some candy. We're going for some little fun right here. And without further ado, guys, if you guys are new here, hit that like and subscribe button because I do tons of content like this. Any geeky stuff you can find on this channel, plus some early movie reviews down below on this channel and over at Sandwich on Films, where you can also go check out some movies and find out how to get to see them early. But without further ado, let's start in 1997. In 1997, I did have an honorable mention. That is Austin Powers. I loved Austin Powers. It's one of my favorite comedies of all time, but it wasn't my favorite. My favorite film in 1997 was actually a film that I watched this year for the first time and I'm obsessed with now, and that is Boogie Nights. Boogie Nights is one of the best crafted films I have ever seen. I think it's actually PTA's best film to date. It is just an epic adventure story through the life of the pornographic industry, and in a sense, it's just really fascinating of a film. Like, the way that the film's made, to all the characters involved in it. Burt Reynolds is awesome in this film. Mark Wahlberg's great. And really, the amount of cast in here that you're like, I remember him, I know her, I know him, I know her. And there's so many wide variety of people in here who are acting their asses off, and everyone's giving a great performance. Boogie Nights succeeds due to the direction and writing. And this was a film that I have no idea, I've never seen it until this year, and I absolutely love it. It's probably gonna end up being one of my favorite films later down the road as more rewatches come into play. 1998, I love The Big Lebowski, but there's one film above that, and that is Small Soldiers. Small Soldiers is a film that really changed my life. Now, I was a fan of Toy Story growing up. Small Soldiers was like the PG-13 version of Toy Story, but live action as well. I want all the toys. I still want all the damn toys for Small Soldiers. I think it's an awesome concept. I think this concept could actually work in today as a remake. I want a remake. I want a Blu-ray version or a 4K version of Small Soldiers. It is an excellent film with so much fun and humor to it, and it still holds up today. I think it is still an entertaining film today. There's a great cast in here, but really it's the toys that come to life and their adventure with one another, and how it kind of tells a message of not to really, you don't judge a book by its cover, and I love that feeling of the movie. Some horrifying moments to it as well, but overall it keeps the tone, contains it, and has a bunch of fun with it. 1999 was a hard year for me. But in 1999, Toy Story 2 and The Matrix both came out, and surprisingly were not my favorite films of this year. My favorite film in 1999 was The Iron Giant. I think this is one of my favorite animated films of all time. I rewatched this film countlessly. I even have a little Iron Giant sitting above me that I've had since probably that year. This was a Burger King toy, and I still have him, and I love him. It's always been a big core crux of my life, was this film. I love rewatching it every couple of months. I just love getting into the feel of it, the character story in here. It really was like one of the best films at that time, and it was one of the most rewatched films as a child for me. Even above Toy Story 2. Like, I love Toy Story. You guys know Toy Story is like, that's my favorite franchise of all time, but Iron Giant really changed it for me overall. Now, moving into the 2000s, Unbreakable comes out, but that's surprisingly not my favorite film on this list. My favorite film in 2000 was The American Psycho with Christian Bale. I love this film to death. I will rewatch this film almost every month, to be honest. It is a gorgeous film that's super highly entertaining to watch, and Christian Bale just kills it. I don't know why. I'm fascinated with these serial killer films and how they tick and how they work, and just like, especially Christian Bale's character in here, the way that he works internally is one of the most fascinating parts of the whole entire film. The moment that he kills Jared Leto in this movie, spoilers if you haven't seen the film, it's been 19 years now, it is a great, like, just kill out of any horror thriller type of film. And the way he does it is just so memorable and one of my favorite kills I've ever seen in a film. 2001 changed my life a lot. And it wasn't because of Monsters, Inc. I like Monsters, Inc. But The Fellowship of the Ring came out this year, and that film dived me into the world of Mordor. I love Lord of the Rings. It's a series that I get a little bit intimidated to go back and rewatch because they're so long and there's so much detail to each and every one. But personally, Fellowship of the Ring is still my favorite Lord of the Rings to date. It's the most rewatchable to me. I can rewatch it any second, and it's just so emotional. It's a great journey going around. The extended edition, I actually think, is the best edition out of all the Lord of the Rings and Hobbit films. And overall, I just think Peter Jackson crafted a masterpiece of this film, easily diving us into this new world, not making it as boring as some epics and other adventure films might make it out to be, but carrying so much lively characters and just a great bunch of characters that you can just fall in love with. 2002 was a really hard film to choose between because I have Catch Me If You Can and Signs. I'm gonna go with Signs on this one because Signs fundamentally fucked me up as a kid. Catch Me If You Can, that second best Spielberg film ever made. We're talking about Signs. Again, Signs fucked me up as a kid. And a lot of it goes to M. Night Shyamalan's direction and writing this. I remember my parents showed me this film when I was super young, probably like right when it came out on VHS and or DVD, whatever it was at the time. And I sat there, watched it, and was freaked out at the news reporting. I would think that like an alien was gonna be outside my window standing on my neighbor's roof, and I was not waiting for that. It was just a film that carried such suspense to it that I believed at the time. I was so fascinated with aliens at this point in time in my life as a child that it was still terrifying to me. And Signs for me is actually still my favorite M. Night Shyamalan film to this fact, because I think it is a creepy. I think Signs adds a lot to that personally, because yeah, it is really creepy, let's be honest with that. Joaquin Phoenix is great, Mel Gibson's great, and even the effects on the alien are cool. The twist at the end with the water thing, I can leave or take it, doesn't really bother me, but I think this is a solid thriller that really made me love filmmaking and gets me into, like, this was my film that really like made me like want to start looking at film. 2003, we got two films that might be under the sea or above the sea, and that is Finding Nemo, as my honorable mention. But my favorite film of that year was Pirates of the Caribbean, Curse of the Black Pearl. My favorite ride at Disneyland at the time was Pirates of the Caribbean. I loved every single ounce of that ride. I loved the water, the boat rides, and I was just obsessed with pirates too, and just the feel of it. And when this film came out, when I went to go see it at the theaters, I remember I was blown away with all the special effects of how they're turning the skeletons. And just in a sense, Jack Sparrow, Johnny Depp himself, playing such a charismatic pirate, but also a really drunk pirate at that. And the amount of love that he gave to this character was just so fascinating. Like, I wanted to be Jack Sparrow. And it even rose above it a little bit more because the other supporting cast was great. But one of my favorite things about Pirates was it just brought me into a new world, which is probably one of the big reasons why I just love this franchise so much. No matter how good or bad some of the other films, they're fun to watch. The mythology is great, and there's a lot of great entertainment value to these films. 2004 was the year of superheroes for this dude right here. And my honorable mention, sadly, is actually The Incredibles, with my favorite film being Spider-Man 2. Now, Spider-Man was my favorite hero as a kid. I love Spider-Man. I will talk about Spider-Man on the daily. He probably still is my favorite superhero of all time. I know a lot of you guys are probably like, but what about Deadpool? I'm sorry, Spider-Man has like always been a big part of my life. I actually need to get a statue of him over here, because I don't have any Spider-Man stuff behind me. Spider-Man 2 fundamentally changed my life. It was depressing for me. Tobey Maguire, Peter Parker retires as Spider-Man, and I'm like, why? They need you. But I think the big part is that I love Doc Ock as a villain. I think Doc Ock is so badass and menacing, and the way that he just works in his antagonist nature towards our main protagonist is one of the most fundamental cool parts of this comic book film, and arguably still one of the best comic book films ever made. Spider-Man 2 is jaw-dropping. It's still the only Spider-Man film, in my opinion, out of the Raimi trilogy that holds up to this date. Great action scene, great emotion. Story is just really realistic and makes sense, and it's overall still one of the best Spider-Man films. Coming into the 2005s, The 40-Year-Old Virgin might have been one of the funniest films I've seen, but Batman Begins is still my favorite Batman film. I think Nolan nailed this film, and the crazy thing about this film is I actually not had seen it until The Dark Knight Rises was coming out. I'd still never gone back and rewatched it. I never got to see it in theaters, but when The Dark Knight Rises was coming out, I was like, I need to go back and watch Batman Begins, went back and I was blown away by this origin story. In a sense, the Batman story. I think this is one of the best origin stories for a comic book superhero and also the best Batman film because it really tackles the layers of him. A lot of the emotion that brings on to his character. The villain Ra's al Ghul is scary, creepy, and awesome. And the way that all the action sequences and everything that Nolan crafts into this film is really expert level. I mean, even The Dark Knight. The Dark Knight is a better film, and I will agree with that. But Batman Begins is a film that really is always solidified in my life as my favorite Batman film every single time I rewatch it. Some people find it boring. I don't. I love a good origin story, and Begins is the top tier origin story that you can get. 2006 was a really hard year for me. I had three films to choose from that I absolutely loved. It was Casino Royale, Mission Impossible 3, and the one that I ended up choosing was Blood Diamond. Blood Diamond is a movie that I remember my dad sitting me down to watch this film and just absolutely being so captivated by every ounce and layer of this film. I really do not think I've ever been this captivated during a film in my younger years. I know, like, there were no superheroes, there were no big explosions. No, I was just so like, what is this film? It was like one of the first dramas that I'd ever actually seen and actually sat through the whole thing without getting up to go to the bathroom or getting up to go get a fake gun and play around and shoot around in the room while my dad's watching a movie. No, like, this film is brutal, it's emotional, it's gritty, and DiCaprio, this was like one of my first introductions to DiCaprio, not just within Catch Me If You Can, but like, this was like my first one where I was like, I love this actor. 2007 actually did the same thing for me again, is fundamentally turning me down and getting me into film and loving film so much. And it wasn't because of Ratatouille, which I love, that would be my honorable mention, but it is because of No Country for Old Men. This is still my favorite Coen Brothers film to date. It's a film that totally horrified me from Javier Bardem's performance in here, and just in general, the awesome cast, the story of revenge, the story in general of just stealing someone's money and just someone hunting you down. It is top tier Coen Brothers, from the script to the story dialogue. I was so happy when this won Best Picture that year. This is essentially the best Coen Brothers film. It's one of the best films ever made, in my opinion, overall. Great cinematography, great performances. What else can you say about No Country for Old Men? We're moving to 2008. I'm sure a lot of you guys are going to think, well, I know what he's going to say for this one. It's the obvious one. It's The Dark Knight. I'm sorry, but no, that's actually my honorable mention. 2008 hosts my favorite comedy of all time, and that is Tropic Thunder. Who does not laugh at this film? You got Robert Downey Jr., who got nominated for a damn Oscar for this film and was hilarious. Jack Black, hilarious. Ben Stiller, hilarious and greatly directed film. Matthew McConaughey's in here, Jay Baruchel, and really the big standout of this film, which we still deserve a sequel to this film, is Les Grossman, Tom Cruise. He stole the film. I didn't even know Tom Cruise was in this film. I think when we first watched this film, no one knew. My family, no one knew that was Tom Cruise. And then by the end, we're like, oh shit. That's the guy from Mission Impossible. It really goes to show you how well Tom Cruise was in this role. The fact that we didn't even notice him. I mean, the same thing would be for Robert Downey Jr. If you didn't know he was in this film, he really transformed into Kirk Lazarus. Everyone transformed these characters. This military comedy, based off actors, based off movies. It's one of my most fascinating films. I love movies and how they make movies, and the fact that they play off a lot of that in this comedy and also other war films, because I love Platoon and Saving Private Ryan. This film, like, I can rewatch this almost every single week and get a good laugh out of it every single time. When I'm feeling down, Tropic Thunder is my main save. 2009 was a really interesting year for me because there's two films that I absolutely loved. And here's the thing, as a kid, like, I would have to really beg my parents to take me to the movie theaters. I'd go every other often. Now I'm going every single day, but 2009, there was two films that I wanted to see so bad, and my dad knew it, and he surprised me by taking me to theaters for both of them. And one of them, my honorable mention, is Zombieland, which I loved Zombieland. It was such a blast in the theater. My main film that is one of my favorite films of all time now, that the trailer, I had to see this film opening night, and I think my dad took me like next day after it previewed, and it was District 9. District 9 is Blomkamp's masterpiece. Like, this film, I just rewatched it a couple days ago, actually. and the fact of how the CGI still holds up to the storytelling and what Neil Blomkamp wants to say in this film, it's all super and solely effective. But the moment that I knew about, that I love about District 9, was how realistically they took this film. How it really felt like this could be happening on the other side of the world just right now as we're talking about, and maybe even one day could. I pulled a lot of hard elements that even as a kid I understood, but also was so gravitized in. The action's gritty, it's emotional, and really you feel for Wickus and the aliens, and I love what Blomkamp did with the script and direction into this film. Writing this whole list, the hardest film on this list was 2010, because let me tell you this, I have three honorable mentions, and all three of these honorable mentions are like some of my favorite films of all time. You have Kick-Ass, The Town, Inception, and of course, in 2010, my second favorite film of all time, Toy Story 3, came out that year. Toy Story 3 is the pinnacle of the whole Toy Story franchise. I'm still excited for Toy Story 4 because I want more with these characters. But Toy Story 3, I have not cried that hard since Toy Story 3. Like, since I saw it in the theater, my whole childhood is Toy Story. Every single film growing up was Toy Story. Like, I rewatched and broke so many VHS players from Toy Story, and just in general, I am such a hardcore fan. I saw the original Buzz and Woody. Like, that is how much I love Toy Story, and Toy Story 3 was like everything I wanted to see and more. I love the emotion, I love how dark, I love how it grew up with me. Like, as I've grown up, it got darker for me, and I get it, it's not the best for all kids. The Clappy Monkey's a little bit scary, it still kind of scares me, but Toy Story 3 was the pinnacle of Pixar. I still think it is the best Pixar film to date, and one of the best films ever made. 2011 was also an interesting year because Fast 5 came out, and I was never the biggest Fast and Furious fan, but Fast 5 really changed my dynamic. I remember these kids from school, they're like, oh, let's go see Fast 5. I'm like, I don't really care. They paid for my ticket. I went with them. Absolutely loved the film. I thought it was awesome. It's my second favorite Fast and Furious film right now. But my favorite film this year was X-Men First Class. This was the film that really made me love the X-Men again. Because I hadn't really loved them since. I was very disappointed with the last couple of films that had come out. But First Class dived me back in. I actually didn't even get to see this in theaters because I didn't care at all for the X-Men. But I remember we got it on DVD, or we rented it from somewhere, and I watched it with my dad, and we were like just blown away with the spectacle around this film and the greatness that Fassbender did with Magneto, even the greatness with Professor X. It was really just a great friendship, and you see why it's torn apart. You really go to see why Magneto is one of the best characters in any comic book film, because he is such a sophisticated and greatly written villain that makes total sense. But I think this film really works because of Matthew Vaughn's direction, and I actually really wish he would have done Days of Future Past, because I think that would have been a really different type of style to First Class, and I would have liked to see his style take over into that film. First Class is still probably my favorite X-Men standalone film in general, and it holds up to today. 2012 released three great films: Looper, Silver Linings Playbook, and my favorite film of that year, Django Unchained. It goes back and forth between a couple Tarantino films, but usually this lands on my favorite Tarantino film. I don't care if it's almost 3 hours. I'll sit through it every single time. I'll watch it all the way through. It's hilarious. It's totally entertaining. It's badass. Jamie Foxx killed the role. Christoph Waltz kills the role. DiCaprio plays one of those most menacing and disturbing villains you've ever seen. And Samuel Jackson has some of the funniest lines in here. Tarantino, this is Tarantino firing on all cylinders, good or bad, whatever you want to think of it as. It's a long film. It's an epic spaghetti western adventure that I don't think we've ever been touched on in a western film in a very long time, but I think Django Unchained nailed every single layer of what it wanted to do, and it just kicks all sorts of ass, and it's all Tarantino's accomplishment. 2013 was a big year for me because I got to see my favorite film of all time that year. Not The Conjuring, but The Conjuring would be my honorable mention. That film scared the shit out of me in theaters. It was The Wolf of Wall Street. Now, The Wolf of Wall Street, again, is still my favorite film of all time. And I've actually told some people, the first time I saw it, I walked out a little bit disappointed. I still liked it, but I didn't love it. I found myself later down the road rewatching this film And ever since that rewatch, it changed my life forever because I legitimately watch this film almost every week. I love putting it on. I love just sitting there and getting engrossed into this three-hour film. I think it's Scorsese's best film. I think it's DiCaprio's best performance. I think McConaughey's excellent in it. I think Jonah Hill's excellent in it. Overall, this film just carries so much energy to it. And the fact that Scorsese directed this film with so much flavor and energy, it's insane. It motivates me, and I love this film. I will watch it any second, and anyone who's never watched it, prepare to watch it with me. 2014, some of you guys are gonna be like, why isn't Whiplash or Gone Girl your favorite film? Well, it's because one of my favorite superhero films came out this year, and that was Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 1. I remember when this film was announced, everyone was shitting on it. I was the only one like, no, this is gonna be amazing. I don't care what you say, a talking raccoon, a talking tree, it's gonna work. Trust me. They get James Gunn involved, people kind of start getting worried. I'm like, no, he's a great director, a great writer, just trust me. Chris Pratt gets in. Really, Chris Pratt? Trust me. Guys, go opening out with a bunch of my friends, and I have never had so many people to eat their words in front of me. That film was so entertaining. I saw that film like 3 times opening weekend. I loved every single second of it. I loved going back and rewatching it and really growing up with Rocket Raccoon, Star-Lord, and Groot in their separate comics when they had first come out were some of the more special things for me because I love those characters so much, and getting to see them realized on the screen was a big fascination for me. The film is so rewatchable, it's so fun, and it's one of my favorite films that I've ever seen in my life. 2015 changed me forever. Mad Max Fury Road might have come out that year, but Star Wars The Force Awakens came back into my life. And man, I loved Star Wars as a kid. And The Force Awakens, I've never cried this hard when a film opened up and the score. I think everyone in the theater was crying. I waited 8 hours for a seat. Me and my friend brought a little DVD player. We brought the original trilogy. We sat back, we watched it. We engaged with a bunch of Star Wars fans, lightsaber fights and all. And then we got Star Wars The Force Awakens. I ditched my last class that year to just get in line for this film. I did not want to miss it. I wanted to get the best damn seat. Gosh, front row, middle seat, right down the middle. And when the opening crawl came up, I just bursted into tears. And man, it was a great experience. It's one of the best theater experiences I've ever had watching a film. 2016 was actually one of the hardest years, again, for me to actually go through because Arrival and La La Land both came out that year. And I think both those films are masterpieces. But my favorite origin story for a superhero film also came out that year, and that was Deadpool. Deadpool is so rewatchable. This is the film that I've actually seen the most in theaters of all time. Opening weekend, I saw it 4 times. I saw it Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. The next weekend, I went again. I saw it Friday and Saturday, and it just kept going down the road where until it left theaters. Anytime someone had not seen the film, I dragged them to the theaters to show the film. I laughed my ass off. More than once or twice in it. I totally just am so engaged. I love the relationship in here. And I'm a sucker for rom-coms. And the fact that they interspliced a romantic comedy also into the superhero film works because you believe in Vanessa's relationship with Wade. And I loved how the relationship really went back and forth. I want my own Vanessa. That's how I want my relationship. That's straight up goals right there. So rewatchable. It's so much fun. Great energy. Great performances. Great acting. Great laughs. It's all around a masterclass origin story for a superhero. Just like I was talking about rom-coms, 2017 was the host of Logan, which was not the rom-com because my favorite film of this year was The Big Sick. Kumail Nanjiani and his wife Emily Gordon wrote a brilliant script, but also just Kumail portraying himself was one of the best choices that they could have done for this film because the relationship that he has with Zoe in here, playing obviously his wife, was just brilliant. It has great performance from Ray Romano and Holly Hunter, but just centers on this beautiful relationship and how it flourishes and how it came out to be. And every single time I watch it, I find myself tearing up, I find myself laughing, and I just found myself overall engaged entirely within The Big Sick. Now we get into 2018. And my favorite film of this year, I mean, you guys knew it from last year, it was Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. A film that I was not really hyped for. The trailer was cool, I was excited for it, but I was still hesitant on a cartoon Spider-Man film. And then I went and saw it and was blown away by this film. I saw this film 3 times in theaters. I love this film to death. It is my favorite Spider-Man film today. It's one of the best comic book films today. I put it at top 10 tier, like best comic book films of all time. The amount of emotion and heart to this story, the amount of just like goosebumps I get every single time I've rewatched this film from Miles' leap of faith is some of the most spectacular stuff I've ever seen in my whole life. And it really comes out and flourishes to just have so much energy to it. If you still have not seen this film, go give it a watch. If you love Spider-Man, if you love comic book films, this is the film for you. All the films, guys. That's all the films we got through the list. We surprised. Let me know what your list down below. What are some of your favorite films from the years that I've been alive? What are some of the films that you've been alive through? And maybe some of the memories. I want to talk about it with you guys down below. And of course, some of you guys are going to be wondering, what is my favorite film of this year so far? Well, I have like a couple. I don't really know. I need to rewatch some of them. It would probably be Us, Long Shot, Shazam, or maybe even Under the Silver. Like, those are four great films that I've seen so far this year that have really taken a toll on me and fighting for my number one spot. But again, guys, thank you guys again so much for watching this. Hit that like and subscribe button. Thanks, Sean Chandler, for this awesome concept. You always bring out these cool, creative things, and I can't thank you guys. And again, happy birthday to me. Sing it down below in the comments, and I'll see you guys soon. Stay classy.